Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for joining us this evening here in Ingle Auditorium for this very special event. My name is David Messenger. I'm the director of the Chester F. Carlson Center for Imaging Science here at RIT. And it's my pleasure to invite or welcome you all here for this very exciting presentation that we're about to see. First of all, I'd really like to thank RIT alumnus and photographer over here in the corner, Mr. Peter Blacksburg. Peter and Dr. Pettit have been friends for several years now, and Peter graciously helped us in coordinating this and organizing this and setting it all up, so thank you very much, Peter. Also, sort of a shameless plug, I'd like to make sure everybody knows that this presentation is actually sort of being offered in sort of coordination with a display over at the University Gallery over in the Vignelli Center. We've taken several of Don's pictures, some of which you'll probably see tonight, and printed them out in very large format, and so that's on exhibit for about the next 6 weeks over in University Gallery. And I really want to thank Wendy Marks, who runs University Gallery. I don't know if Wendy's here right now, for setting that up. And I encourage you all to stop by sometime over the next month or so. So we're very pleased to have Dr. Don Pettit, NASA astronaut, with us here today. Don was selected by NASA in 1996, was when he joined the space program, and he was telling us it was after several years of trying. He holds a Bachelor of Science in Chemical Engineering from the Oregon State University and a Doctorate in Chemical Engineering from the University of Arizona. Before he was an astronaut, he worked for several years at the Los Alamos National Laboratory. He is a veteran of three space flights. He served as the NASA Science Officer for Expedition 6 in 2003. He's operated the robotic arm for STS-126 in 2008 and served as the flight engineer for Expedition 30/31 in 2012, where he lived aboard the International Space Station. In total, Don has a little more than 1 year total time on space station. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Don Pettit here tonight.
I like the concept of a frontier. A frontier is a place where your normal intuition doesn't necessarily apply. A frontier is when things don't necessarily happen the way they do back at home. And frontiers can be many places. They can be under the stage of a microscope, through the eyepiece of a telescope, bottom of the ocean, stratosphere. My frontier is space. And we see a picture here of one of my homes away from home. This is the International Space Station. It's huge. It's 100 meters in almost any direction that you want to look at. And just the air inside a space station, if you were to replace it, the air inside a space station is a ton, a metric ton, a little over 1,200 kilograms, just to replace the air on space station. So it's this huge platform, and it's set up in low Earth orbit, and it is intended for doing scientific research. And this is a frontier in orbit around Earth. And one of the things I like to illustrate on the frontier can be seen with this picture. This is one of the windows on space station. It's in the cupola, which is a collection of seven windows that approximate a hemisphere. And these seven windows look at Earth. And you can use it for all kinds of amazing observations and photography. This picture happens to be somewhere over China, looking past the Himalayas into India. And if you know where to look, Mount Everest is in this picture. Dozens of astronauts have taken tens of thousands of pictures through this window. And you could get in the mindset that, why should I take a picture out this window? Because it's already been done. People have already done that. But you have to remember, you're in a frontier. And when you're in such a place, the way you make an observation can change what you see. So here's a window, and I'm going to set the camera up a little differently. And here's what you see. Same window, same planet, same view out the window, but it's at nighttime, and you've tweaked the camera up so you can see what's going on at night. And look at that, aurora. It's amazing. It's a new observation, but it's the same place. And then you change the camera again, and you see this. This is a time exposure. Cities are smeared on Earth. Stars are streaks. But and you can see lightning flashes from a single storm as it moves in time. A different set of observations just because you changed the way that you made the observation. So the very concept of been there, done that does not apply to a frontier. So if you ever find yourself in an environment and you say, oh, somebody else has already done that, why should I even bother to do it? Strike that thought from your mind, because you can go into a place where many people have been before, and you make a new observation, you change your viewpoint, and you can see new things, and you can collect new data. And that happens time and time again in frontiers that are all around us, and you can do it in space. So here is what I wanted to be the title of my talk, Science of Opportunity. And this is on the space station, where you can work on clandestine science projects. These are things that after you've quit for the day, you're in this amazing orbital laboratory. Why don't you use the equipment that you have available to make some scientific observations? But this is kind of a boring title. So I thought, well, maybe I should call this Unexpected Consequences from Microgravity. And well, I was scratching my head thinking about these titles. No, I don't like that one. So then I gravitated on this, Techno Stories from Space. Because after all, we are geared towards stories, from just sitting around the campfire listening to what happened to reading the newspaper. A lot of these things are just stories. And I thought, well, I could tell some techno stories from space. But then I thought, well, maybe there's another title that might fit what I'm gonna tell you tonight. And here's what I came up with. Scientific advances from what appears to be goofing around in space. So this is really what I'm going to be telling you tonight. Techno stories that have their roots from goofing around in space. However, they end up with something that is actually meaningful. So let me start off with this. Okay. This is a big sphere of water. It's about the size of my head. And I have it fixed in front of the video camera with a little piece of wire so it won't float away. I mean, this is a big sphere, you know. And after you've flown in space, your head, everybody says your head swells up a little more, particularly when you come back to Earth. And so this is a big sphere of water. And I made this simply, well, for two reasons. One, just because I was in space and I could. And nobody had made a sphere of water this big before, and I knew that the ratio of surface tension force to inertial force is going to decrease. This ratio is going to decrease as the sphere gets larger and larger and larger, and this is just a fancy way of saying that the role of surface tension in terms of making this into a sphere will decrease as your sphere gets larger and larger. So a small sphere will want to stay a sphere, where a large sphere may not want to really stay a sphere. And so I thought, well, let me see what's going to happen. And I have a syringe up there on the left-hand side, and I could put a 25 milliliter puff of air radially directed into this sphere from about 25 to 30 millimeters, and I could do that in a tenth of a second. So let's see what happens. There we go. Puff. It's like, whoa, that's just a jaw-dropping moment. Look, and remember, I'm just goofing around. What's happening here? This is real time. And this is so cool, we're going to see it again. See, look at that. Now, this is slow motion. Look at that. And there's a lot of physics going on here. And what occurred to me is this is like throwing a rock in a spherical pond where you have the ripples going out, but they're forced to confine to the outside. Look at that. They're forced to confine to the outside of the sphere, and they move to the diameter chord, and then they converge at 180 degrees away from impact. That's the antipode. And the spurt goes out, and surface tension makes that collapse, and you just get this delightful oscillation of surface waves. Meanwhile, body-centered waves make the sphere oscillate, so you get all this delightful superposition of all of these waves, which physics people just love, of course. And they keep going on and on and on until viscous dissipation stops the whole thing. And it's like, wow! What, before I did this, I had no idea what was going to happen. And when I saw it, it's like, whoa, what is happening? And then I was able to dissect the results using known principles of physics, things that I learned in school, just like everyone here is learning things in school. And you can learn this stuff. And what happened here? We seem to have lost our image of this. Anyway, yes, it is.
Sorry, folks. Hold on a second.
Anyway, so when you're in a frontier, you can start off in a direction and you have no idea what's going to happen. You might be guided by a hunch, like, well, surface tension forces are going to increase or decrease or whatever. Then you make an observation. It's like, wow, what's going on? And then you can use your physics that you understand to describe what happened, but you couldn't have done it the other way around. You couldn't have taken knowledge and predicted what was going to happen until you made the observation. So, this is just goofing around, right? But then, at the Physics of Fluids conference, this this set of images, this was back in 2005, was chosen as the fluid physics video of the year. And so remember, I was just goofing around. Yet this goofing around ended up tickling people's minds enough that it made it into the Physics of Fluids. Now here's another example of just goofing around in space. I made these wire loops from scrap wire on station, and the idea is I was going to use them to make soap films. What would a soap film do in a weightless environment? Because there's no gravitational driven drainage, and it's like maybe something cool is going to happen. And so I set up to take pictures of these films, and you can see I needed a dark background, so I used one of my cleanest dirty shirts. and so I set these wire loops up like that. But before I put soap on them, I thought, let me just try this with pure water. And we have pretty pure water on station. It's like 10 mega ohm water. It's deionized water, really pure stuff. And I found I could make films with pure water. The surfactant's not needed. You can't do that down here. And here's a video of that being done, where I have a wire loop and there's some of this water, and I'm drawing off this film of water. And here's a side view of that, where you can make these films anywhere from a couple millimeters thick, which is really not a film anymore, and you can make them down to 40 microns thick, which is actually something you could call a film. And so you can draw these structures in the wingless environment, made out of pure water with no surfactants. And you can use these now as an example of a two-dimensional beaker where you can look at phenomena like this. This is food coloring, and you're making structures that are truly two-dimensional in nature because flow perpendicular to the film doesn't happen because it's so thin. And that, by the way, is a two-dimensional vortex ring. Instead of being this donut thing, it's what a vortex ring would look like if you took a cross-section through it. And then this shows various forms of mixing. These are tracer particles, and you give it a little stir, and you see these mixing patterns in two-dimensional fluid flow, and then you can have these patterns. You wait till the fluid flow stops, and now you can set up a series of patterns like this, which you can use to look at other kinds of fluid flow. So just goofing around with wanting to make water with soap films led to these two-dimensional beakers, where you could look now at fluid flow issues in a two-dimensional state in a weightless environment. And what I came up with was, let's grow some crystals in a two-dimensional crystallizer. So on station, we have basically a zero gravity salt shaker, which you can imagine would be a mess without gravity, right? You want to put a little salt in your food, how does that go? And so what it is, it's a squeeze bottle of a nearly saturated solution of sodium chloride. And our food's pretty salty anyway, so nobody was using it, so I thought, let me take the nearly saturated solution of sodium chloride and let me draw some thin films, I'll let it evaporate, let sodium chloride crystals grow, and see what happens if you have a two-dimensional crystallizer like this. And here's some examples of sodium chloride crystals growing, and here's a little movie that actually time-lapse over a period of a couple of days and shows how these crystals grow due to evaporation. And here are some of the results. Some of these crystals, they'll be wafer thin, and they'll be 20 millimeters on an edge. And then you can see little whiskers growing out from them. And depending on the orientation in which the seed crystal started, because it can only grow in a flat plane, you can get different kinds of tabular crystal growth. So I was messing around with this, and I ran across a fellow from Switzerland that works in the salt industry. And we got together and we wrote this paper, Characterization of Sodium Chloride Crystals Grown in Microgravity. And this was published in the journal Crystal Growth. So this is a really good journal. If you were a assistant professor at RIT and you were publishing papers in this, it would help you get tenure. And so we published this one paper, and then on my next mission I continued to do the salt crystal work, and remember, we're just goofing around, and we got a second paper published, sodium chloride crystallization from thin liquid sheets, thick layers, and sessile drops. That's really interesting stuff. And so now, here's another example where we made these stationary patterns in this two-dimensional fluid container, and I bring a soldering iron up to it. And I did this, well, you know, why not? You're in space. And look what's happening. You're inciting motion in this two-dimensional sheet. And this has a name. It's often called Marangoni convection, named after a physicist from Italy, but it's really called thermal capillary flow. And so I did a whole bunch of goofing around outside of normal working hours with this, and I was able to get a paper published in the proceedings of the European Conference on Microfluidics with colleagues of mine from Tokyo University in Japan. And where these people at the university analyzed the fluid flow in this thermal capillary demonstration on space station. And talking with Yena-san after this, he told me that his theoretical calculations with his students would be if the top one on a convex surface, which was what I had initially done, the fluid motion would be towards the hot wall, which is exactly what we saw. But he said, if I could make a concave surface as this two-dimensional sheet, the fluid motion would be away from the hot wall. And I thought, wow, that's interesting. Theoretical prediction based on subtle changes in this geometry. So on my next flight, I made a thin film that was concaved, and look at that. It actually moves away from the hot source. So Yena-san and his calculations were correct. And as a result of that, we got another paper published in Microgravity Sciences. And here we were able to take his theoretical calculations from his research group at Tokyo University and coupled with the video. And the way we do this is, if you set the video up correctly and you get nice parallel or perpendicular views and you have length scale and you know framing rate, now you can get, and you have tracer particles, you can get location as a function of time, and from that you can get velocity, and then you can get acceleration, and you can get all of these physical parameters measured from something as simple as taking a video, and then you can apply that to your theoretical model, and then you can publish papers. And so this all comes from just goofing around because you happen to find yourself in a laboratory in orbit. Now here's, we're going to see a little bit of a video, again, a goofing around.
Take one.
I'm Don Pettit. I'm on the International Space Station. I have a Lego kit here, and we have the official NASA Space Station Lego instruction booklet. The whole concept of Legos to me is not following the instructions. So I'm gonna just give the instruction booklet a push. Look what I made. Got a big rubber band here. Now I used some Lego wheels. This is the basis for a Van de Graaff generator. Instead of having a spherical collector, let's make a cylindrical collector. I happen to have some aluminum foil, and so I rolled it into this cylinder. This may not be ideal. It's probably going to be good enough. I happen to have a drill driver here. So this isn't little kid stuff anymore. I found a sphere. I can get sparks here about 2 inches long. That's probably close to 120,000 volts.
So, from a NASA educational demonstration, I was able to throw the instruction book away, which, by the way, any self-respecting kid when they're playing with Legos, you know, what do you do with the instructions? And of course, this concept stays with kids, particularly guys, when you grow up. It's like, you get IKEA furniture, do you follow the instructions? No, we don't follow instructions, we're guys. You throw them away and your set of drawers has, you know, 6 slots in it instead of 5, and you wonder, well, where's that extra drawer, what happened? But anyway, you throw away the instructions, and remember, you're just goofing around, and instead of making some little Lego thing, you make a Van de Graaff generator. This thing, particularly after I found that sphere, it was able to make about 120,000 volt spark. And it's static electric, right? So it's not dangerous. And so what do you do with this after you get it made? And so I thought, well, let's see what we could do with it. And so here I'm squirting water around, and
you can put water droplets in orbit around the sphere. So here you use an electrostatic force instead of gravity force, but this like satellites going around. And then around Earth. And then you can put water directly on the sphere and you can drive all these really neat little conical peaks and they squirt little droplets off and all of this. And so I shot hours and hours of video. And I thought it was just cool stuff. Look at that. And then I ran across a fellow from New Jersey Institute of Technology, and a faculty member there, and he saw this and said, these are Taylor cones. It turns out there's a whole study, a field of little tiny charged, when you charge a liquid like water, it will stand up in these little tiny cones, and it'll squirt little droplets off. And there's a whole technology field where they use this for spray technologies, like spray, electrostatic charge transfer of paint, spray paint, even things in inkjet printers can be based off of this Taylor cones. And so he wanted the video, and he took some students, chained them to a desk computer, put them in a room with a desk computer, chained them to them, and they analyzed the video. And we came up with these results here, where here, this is a log scale of characteristic height of these Taylor cones. And this is a log of a time scale. And this is a standard way to present this information. And here's all of his Earth data. And this is based on Taylor cones that are real tiny. Half a millimeter sized cone is the largest you can make because of Earth's gravity. But look what you can do on space station. You can make Taylor cones that were 5 centimeters long. So inadvertently, I was able to expand the data set by a factor of 100 here, from 0.5 millimeters to 5 centimeters. And then if you plot this on the coordinate space, and again, it's log-log, so everything looks good on log-log, right? But here's his data, and here's the data taken from the LIGO based Van de Graaff generator, and here's a theoretical line that is based on theory, and his data goes through it, and it looks like my data goes through it, and it looks like everybody's happy on that. So we were just goofing around, and we were able to get something like that. And then we ended up with a paper in FizRev Letters. Okay, if you're an assistant professor, you could use this to help get you promoted with tenure. And Boris Herson was the major professor I was working with. But the coolest thing about this, so this is published in FizRev Letters, but this is what I like about it. This is a passage from the paper. Van de Graaff generator assembled from Legos. Published in FizRev Letters. The detail in the supplemental material. So now, here, goofing around in space, playing with Legos. But remember, you're in a frontier. And you can use Clorox bottles and cottage cheese cartons and Legos if you're in a frontier, and you can assemble pioneering apparatus and make new observations. And again, it's partly because you're in this frontier environment. But remember, these frontier environments are all around us. And all you have to do is put on your thinking cap and charge off and do something, and you don't necessarily need a laboratory filled with millions of dollars worth of stuff. Clorox bottles, cottage cheese cartons, a few Legos, and you're off to making peer-reviewed publications in journals like this. Okay, this is way cool. This this is a cup, an open container. And in weightlessness, you have to drink your fluid. You know, an open a container doesn't work, right? A cup doesn't work. The fluid would stay in the bottom, and you tip it up, it's still in the bottom. Now it's in your hand, it doesn't come out. And if you move around too much, it sloshes out, makes a big mess. And I wanted to have a container that would hold fluid that you could drink in a weightless environment, that you don't have to suck all your stuff from a bag and through a straw. And I remembered some of my fluid physics. You know, my major professor was probably thinking I was just sleeping in his surface chemistry class, but apparently, you know, it was soaking in, and I remembered the saying about capillary-driven channel flow. And so I made this on orbit out of a piece of plastic sheeting and capped on tape. And notice it's a cup, but it's distorted, and it has an acute angle that runs up the side. And that acute angle makes a channel that capillary-driven forces will force fluid up that channel, and it'll park on the rim. So look at this. So there it is on the space station, and I'm putting tea in it. And notice how the fluid climbs up that channel. And there's a stability criteria for whether that happens. If that acute angle is less than 2 × 90 minus the wetting angle, you'll drive channel flow. And so there's Steve Bowen and I drinking out of open containers, which was impossible before this. And see, you can orientation makes no difference, and students don't do that at home. And there we are, you can drink these saints to dryness. So now, I made 6 of these saints, and so everybody on the crew had them. And for the first time, we could do a toast of tea and coffee after a hard day's work. You know, maybe you came in from a spacewalk, maybe you flew the robotic arm and you captured the first commercial spacecraft that came up to station, and no pressure. Only the future of commercial space industry hinged on your ability to fly the arm and capture it. Remember, no pressure. And after a day like that, you and your crew, you can sit there and celebrate with a tea toast at the end of the day in a manner that's commensurate with how everybody lives life here on Earth. And it's just not the same if you have bags of tea and you just go squish together. So we made a second generation version, and this is with a colleague of mine, Mark Weisslagel at Portland State University. And his students, Mark and his students, came up with this cool design. And this shape is purely driven from the mathematics of fluid physics applied to making an open container in a weightless environment. There's no art at all in this. But like so many things that are driven by mathematics, before human beings have a chance to stir things around, it turns out to make something that has a high aesthetic measure. And so we have these on station, and this became a formal NASA-funded experiment. And here's an example of how it works. Look at that. And so we took these videos, carefully planned videos, so that you have good views of the surface profile, and you know your framing rate, you know the length scale, and you can see what the drainage pattern is in this cup. And then again, you can take Mark Weisslagel did this. You could take your favorite graduate student, you chain them to a desk computer, and you have them analyze this frame by frame, and you can get all the flow fields from this. And you know, you can throw a hamburger in there a couple times a day to keep this fellow happy. And you end up with all this data. And look at this now. This is the kind of thing you can get from simple imagery. Here's the imagery from the video. You can get position as a function of time. From that, you can get velocity.
And then you can get acceleration, and then you can get frequency because there's oscillations in there, and you can follow these things because there are bubbles. And so you get all of that information, and then you can use this, and you can publish papers. And we've got one paper published in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics, and then we're working on another paper right now based on this capillary cup experiment was the official name. So here's kind of the result from us goofing around. There's the original version conceived and built in on the space station and taped together from stuff that was there. And then there's a 3D plastic printed one that Mark Weisslagel and his students designed. And then I've been slip casting porcelain versions in my garage at home just because these things are kind of cool, and you can sip your espresso from them. And again, it's just coffee. We were goofing around. Now, here's a photo. I really like this photo. It's a self-portrait, and it's taken in the cupola module, and this is that module that's seven windows in a hemisphere. And I like to call this the view of my view. And one of the neat things about looking at Earth, particularly at night, are the images of cities. And if you take a camera and you just take a picture of a city, this is Montreal. They're kind of fuzzy because you gotta hand track the camera and you take the picture. And this was taken at the era where 400 ISO was the fastest digital camera that we had on station. And these are about 1 to 1.5 second exposures, and you're doing hand tracking. And this is about the best that you could do at this point in time. The cities are so beautiful and so much detail with your eye, but your pictures turn out like this. And I was disappointed, and I wanted to do something different. So I cobbled this up from junk on station. And I remember, I was just goofing around. So this black thing is a part of a mount system that was meant to hold the IMAX movie camera that filmed a couple of movies on Space Station. But we didn't have an IMAX movie camera anymore, and this mount was just sitting in a closet waiting to be deorbited. And so I figured nobody'd mind if I use it. And then I mounted on one axis of gimbal, I cobbled up this long threaded bolt that you turn with a drill driver. And when you rotate the drill driver, the bolt turns and it pushes on one part of the mount, and you can smoothly move one axis very precisely. And you can change the rate it moves by how much you pull on the trigger. And then I took this old Hasselblad camera that we had on orbit that we'd run out of film, we don't use it anymore. And I'm using it as a fancy spotting scope. And then here I've got our digital camera with a cable release. So what you do, you mount this on the window, you look at images of cities at night through the Hasselblad, and then you pull on the trigger until you get those images stationary. And then you take pictures with the digital camera. And so I put this together, and if you're an amateur astronomer, you'll realize that this is nothing more than what we call a barn door tracker, which is a very simple device where you have a bolt with a screw, and you turn the bolt maybe a quarter turn every 20 seconds. And by doing that, the camera that you have mounted on this piece of plywood moves, and you can take long pictures of space from Earth, and the stars will be pinpoints. And so I'm basically making a barn door tracker in space to counteract orbital motion to take pictures of Earth. And so here it is being used. So you match the rates, and then you take pictures, and then when you run out of threaded bolt, you gotta backtrack and do it all over again. And then you can reorient it. So I put this barn door tracker together,
to take pictures of cities at night. And again, this is the best that we were able to do with our digital cameras at the time of Montreal. And here's what Montreal looks like with the barn door tracker. And we can get down to about 50 meter resolution with this particular system. So once I had this system in place, then it was just a question of any time you had a spare moment, you started taking pictures of cities at night. And here's Chicago. This is Las Vegas. And what's neat here is here's McCarran Field. And the grand irony is airports and landing strips are dark at night. And so it's strange that when you land an airplane, you want a dark field. But you can see here McCarran Field is there are the two runways. And then that's the strip right there. And it's really, really bright. I like to refer to Las Vegas, it's the beacon for humanity. This is a mosaic that I put together, Los Angeles, Long Beach, going all the way down to San Diego. And so you can take these pictures, stitch them together, you can make really detailed mosaics of cities at night. And I ran into a fellow at NOAA, and he was looking at these pictures because we didn't have these. And so he was doing the brunt work. He was writing all these papers, but this is a paper in the International Journal of Remote Sensing. And so we had all of these really well-known people looking at Earth at nighttime, and then they stuck me in there with the pictures taken from this barn door tracker. And so we got that one, and then look at that. Then here's another one, and this was in the Geo Journal, published in 2007, a potential for global mapping of development via Nightsat mission. And then I think there one more? No, that's it. Observational considerations for water resolution nighttime light. So he's prolific. I mean, Chris Elveridge, he was able to take these pictures and get three publications, bang, 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 from them. And right now, that barn door tracker, it got deorbited, it got burned up. But our digital cameras have advanced to the point with ISOs like 12,800 or even higher. And you can hand track now and take wonderful pictures of cities at night without having to use a tracker like that. But it took about the time period of 2012, 2013 before this tracker that I made in 2002, before it became obsolete. Now, and remember, we're just goofing around in space, right? Oh. This is the last subject, and now I promise I'll stop talking. That's a picture of my foot. This is after about 3 weeks of being on orbit, maybe 2 weeks. And what happens? You don't use your feet to walk on in space. You use your feet to curl around handrails, but they're really not handrails because they're foot rails. And you anchor yourself to whatever surface, the deck or the ceiling or the walls, and you stick your foot underneath a handrail and then you kind of pull up with your toes and that anchors you. And then you got your hands free and you can do things. And the skin on the top of your foot is pretty tender stuff because we don't walk around on the tops of our feet down here, we walk around on the bottoms of our feet. And this is what happens when you go into space. The bottoms of your feet, you don't need them. But the tops of your feet get all red and raw like that, and they get really sore. And so, here's what NASA provided us. They provide us with these moccasin-type shoe slippers.
And these are just an off-the-shelf item. These are designed for people on Earth. And look, you've got all that leather on the bottom to protect your feet, and all you have is a little bit of a knit stuff on the top of your foot. That doesn't do a good job of protecting your feet. And you can see here, so that's how you would use this. There's a handrail that you really use as a foot rail, and you stick your foot underneath it. You've got some padding, but the real padding's on the bottom of your foot. You don't need that in space. So what would any self-respecting astronaut do that throws the Lego instruction away? You do a shoe sole rectomy, and you cut the bottom of the sole off, and you sew it on the top part of your shoe, right? And so now, look at the difference. See, the foot on the left has the leather where you really need it, and you don't need it on the bottom, and the shoe on the slipper on the right, that's an earth slipper. And you know, it just shows that if you're used to a certain thing on Earth, right, it doesn't necessarily apply. You're in this frontier environment. What works on Earth may not work well in space. And so just goofing around and did this. Well, NASA has these student projects. They're called the Hunch Program. These are high school students that take an issue or some problem that has been defined from the astronauts on orbit, and they will make hardware to solve that problem. And so some students saw this, and they said, we could make a zero gravity slipper. So here's the result of the student project. This is flight hardware, all packaged up, ready to be launched. And notice, they laser burn the patch onto each one of these things. And then here it is on space station. There's one of the crews, each one with their little laser etched slippers on orbit. And all of these were made by high school students. That hardware itself was designed and made and sewed by high school students working in the Hunch program at NASA. And this solves a real problem. Plus, the astronauts get a real cool souvenir after the flight, as you've got this slipper, which has no use at all on Earth. Because, I mean, what are you going to use it for? You can't even, I mean, you put it on, walk around, and get splinters in your feet. But it looks really cool, and you've got your mission patch on it. So again, you're just goofing around, and you end up with something that turns out to be useful. And I'd like to end with this. Here's a picture of me, a little movie, and I'm playing with yo-yos in zero gravity, which has some really neat, delightful physics that's different. Look at this. You can do yo-yo tricks in weightlessness in a way that you can never do on Earth. And you get to name them. I call this the tether assist. Look at that. And this is sort of the paragon example of goofing around in space. And to be honest, I haven't come up with any useful and scientific advances from yo-yos, but I'm still working on that. And this truly does get me to my last slide right there. That's a self-portrait in the cupola module looking out. And I really love the concept of frontiers. And there are frontiers all around us. Choose a frontier that sings to your heart. And don't worry about whether somebody's already been there and done something before. All you need to do is go into your frontier. Make some observations that are unique, observations in a way that nobody else has made an observation before. And you can truly make new discoveries. And you don't need a laboratory filled with millions of dollars of equipment. You can get by with Legos and explore the frontiers and see what's going to happen. Space is my frontier. Find your own frontier and do some exploring.
Thank you all very much. First of all, for all the pre-tenured faculty in the crowd, apparently everybody wants to go to Space Station now because it's an excellent place to get publications. We actually have some time for questions and answers. There's a couple of microphones down
here.
Lights up. We have some time for some questions and answers. If we could turn the lights up a little bit, that would be great. We have two microphones down here. If you'd like to come ask Don a question, feel free to stop down.
And if you can't get to the mic, we'll bring it to you. So we just get a seat if you can.
And we got to turn the microphone on.
And say your name, please.
My name is Drew Walters. That was a fantastic presentation. You described fooling around, goofing around in space, but before you go out to the frontier, you have to carefully consider what you bring from the homestead. So, to what extent do you plan these free time missions? Why did you bring Legos?
Good question about how much planning do you do for these clandestine experiments? And sometimes you stage a few things, like the Legos were already on station because it was a NASA educational thing. And you just kind of figure out, well, gosh, what else could I do with these Legos? And you just sort of let your mind wander and you come up with a new experiment. Some of them, like the thermal capillary flow experiment, I knew before I launched that I wanted to make a concave surface instead of a convex surface. So that was an example of something that I had planned before I launched, was, wow, let me see what I could do to make a slightly convex surface, or a concave surface, and see what the thermal capillary flow will be. The coffee cups, that was just something that came on orbit, and you just find the materials. Because you're in a world-class laboratory, there's all kinds of stuff there, and you have to be careful what you use, because there's limited resources, and you don't want to use something that was slated for a bona fide experiment. But if you could find leftover bits from other experiments, you could go ahead and use them. Some of the stuff you think about ahead of time, some of the stuff you just do because you're on orbit. Next question.
How many G-forces do you take when you leave Earth's atmosphere and enter Earth's
atmosphere? Okay, say again, please.
How many G-forces do you take when you leave Earth's atmosphere and enter Earth?
What's the G-force when you leave and enter the atmosphere?
Oh, what's the G-force? Okay. Depends on the rocket that you launch on and whether you're doing a normal entry or not. If you launch on the space shuttle, 3 G's, 3 times normal gravity, is what you feel on a shuttle launch. If you launch on a Russian Soyuz rocket, it's about 3.5 G's. And then on entry, because you have to deaccelerate, for the shuttle, it's about 1.5 G's. And remember, it comes in like an airplane, and so it can't take as high a G's as like a capsule. For the Soyuz, the normal G loading is around 3.5 G's when you come in. One of my Soyuz flights, we had a malfunction, and we augured into the atmosphere at a steeper rate than what is designed. This is called a ballistic entry. And we did a ballistic entry because we lost our reaction control system, so we couldn't control the capsule. And we peaked at 9 G's coming in. And so in my space suit with all the stuff, I weighed 1,800 pounds. But the capsule's designed to handle these loadings, and we're trained to handle these loadings. We do training in centrifuges. And your body position, this is really important. If you're going to be pulling high G's and you're sitting up, you can black out. But if you're laying on your back, which is what you do in space capsules, you can pull real high G's, and because your head is basically at the same elevation as your heart's pumping, here's your head, heart's going like this, the difference in height between your heart pumping and your head is, they're almost at the same level, and so your heart doesn't have to pump real hard to get the blood to your head, and you can maintain your conscious state and you can continue to fly your spacecraft. So that's one of the reasons why you lay on your back in a spacecraft, so that you can keep your brain working if you happen to pull high G's. Yes, do you have a question?
How do you take a self-portrait?
Well, it's not quite like pulling out your iPhone and doing a selfie. We've got professional level cameras, and they have built-in timers, and you can program them to take pictures, and so you can set it up on a clamp. It's kind of like a tripod, but it's really a clamp. It's like an arm, and you clamp one end of the arm to a handrail, and the other end has a camera on it, and you set the camera up with the field of view you want, and then you float over to where you need to be, and you have the camera take a picture. To take this picture, I set the camera up in the Russian segment in front of a window there that looks at the US segment, and it looks at the cupola. And so I set the camera up, and then I quickly zoomed from the Russian segment through all the different passages and things and popped my head up into the cupola just when it took a picture. And I had to do this a bunch of times in order to get it. Yeah.
You mentioned like a commercial mission or something during the presentation. What exactly was that?
Okay, the SpaceX mission that happened when I was on station, it was Dragon D1. And the D meant for demo, and 1 minute was the first demo mission. So this was the first time that SpaceX launched a commercial cargo vehicle that was actually going to fly close to station, demonstrate that it could fly in formation with station. But then folks decided, well, if it flies that close to the station, why don't we just go ahead and have it dock, and then we can load some goodies inside of it, and we can make it a cargo mission. So instead of just making it a demonstration test mission, they made it a full-up cargo mission, and so that was called Dragon D1, and it flew up to station and stopped at 10 meters, and then I flew the robotic arm and grabbed the thing and brought it into station. And docked it, and then we opened the hatch, and there's all kinds of goodies inside of there for us. So that was the Dragon D1 mission, and then we unloaded all the goodies, and it was docked to station for maybe 3 weeks, and then we filled it full of all kinds of other things that were going to be returned to Earth, and that was the first time that we'd been able to get a commercial spacecraft to not only bring stuff up to station, but also bring things back down to Earth. And now the SpaceX Dragon vehicle brings the results from scientific experiments down to Earth with every mission. And that's one of the ways that we can get significant payloads back down for scientific analysis. Any more questions? Okay.
About one more question, would that be right?
Okay, one more question, and let me do one more question, and let's see.
Do you have any moment that's like your most favorite moment of when you were in space?
So your most favorite
moment?
Gosh, there are so many favorite moments. It's like choosing what is your favorite food or what is your favorite movie. It depends on your mood. Certainly, looking out at Earth in the cupola is a favorite pastime for astronauts. And not just me, but almost anybody that goes up there. You don't float into your windowless sleep station and spend all your spare time doing email. You could do that down here on Earth. Let me ask one other thing. Would folks mind, I have a video that shows another little experiment that I did on station. that it's like 3 minutes. Would people mind if I just end with that video? Are y'all bored? So let me show this video. It's gonna come on here.
You can kill the lights for this.
We have, let me get a big angle at that water sphere now, is about 62 millimeters in diameter. And just gauging, it looks like that air bubble is about 40. And the air bubble is attached to the speaker cone, and so is the water. And I'm at 60 hertz. I'm going to start increasing the amplitude. Here we go. Wow. So we're getting a series of standing nodes on the interface of the air bubble with the water. I'm going to put a square wave in. Okay. Triangle wave. Wow. Let me go to 150. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Everyone, as an alumnus of this place 40 years ago, I graduated plus, I was on the stage. Each of you who goes to this school can contribute back by bringing something of your future back to this school. I hope you do 40 years from now. Thank you.